far cry from what we have, isn't it, buddy?
Yeah. Jen, that's my fiance.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
He why you couldn't see me.
I think that's what it was, yeah.
I called him up and I said, hey, let's get a drink. He goes, we have seen down here. I'm getting a drink or shot.
Neighbors.
So we were right where we were. So we might have been close. When you saw Simon Adam,
you
were
second. You were at the top. You sat at the top.
Yeah, we went.
Yeah,
that's what I was just telling you. We were.
No, that wasn't Bach. You kind of saw him with really good Bach.
No, it wasn't.
Was,
that's Mahler.
The new day to get simple. Sam and I had sat behind the
wall. I'm not sure. That's why. Yeah, we wanted to find some more before.
Yeah.
So we went there, and then we came home right. But I was.
Wow. 32 years I've been doing recitals in Esper, and here we are tonight doing it here in our new concert hall. It's exciting for me, it's exciting for all of us, and thanks to all the people that made this possible. Just this past month, there was a passing in the trombone world. Seems like there's been a lot of that lately, but this particular man, Urban Clifford Brown, who we all knew as Irby, was probably the most influential trombonist that I can think of in the last half of the century. I know for me, he was sort of at his height when I was in, when I first started playing in high school. And some of the things that I heard him do, it changed our lives. It changed all of our lives that were around at that time. And his career started humbly. He's from Alabama, kind of a quiet, shy Southern boy, and he started out, one of the things that he did in his early career was play with the Woody Herman Band, which I had the pleasure to do, and I actually had the pleasure of recording an alumni album with Woody's band, where Irby came back and played Bijou, the famous tune Bijou. Funny Irby story with that was that Irby was telling us after we had recorded, he said, he was kind of laughing, he goes, there was a famous trombone player on Woody's band before, Bill Harris, very fun, and Bill had a very distinct style of playing the trombone, and he played his solo on Bijou, and when Irby first joined the band, he would just play Bill Harris's solo over and over and over again, and finally Woody came to him and said, you know, you don't have to do that, you know. But Irby just had that kind of respect, and he was just such a gentleman. He was loved by the entire trombone community, right up until he passed away in December at the age of 92. So I couldn't imagine starting or doing tonight's program without doing something in tribute to Irby. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is Irby performing Bach Gounod's Ave Maria off an album called Being Green that I absolutely wore out. And we'll follow that with another tune from that same album. But here's Irby playing Ave Maria. Hey, we're going to do what we can to keep things moving the best that we can here this evening. Ever since I knew that we were going to be doing this recital in this room, I knew I wanted to try to do something special. And for years, I've known these next two gentlemen professionally, and we've played some together, and we've taught together, and more importantly than anything, they have just inspired all of us in the state of Pennsylvania and beyond. They are two of the finest musicians playing the trombone today. And so for us to have these two gentlemen here is a thrill, and I can't wait for you to hear them. We're going to play a Pergolesi trio sonata transcribed for three trombones. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Nitzan Haros and Pete Sullivan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. It's great to be here. Thanks, for Mark, for inviting me, and Nitsan. Always great. So Mark asked me to do something a little different. He wanted some variety. So I'm going to do something different, okay? And I never thought I'd play on the same half of a concert as Irby Green, so I'm kind of nervous about that. Irby was my hero as a kid. And I still tell my students, by the way, shout out to my Carnegie Mellon students up there. I always tell my students, if you want an example of the perfect legato, just listen to Irby Green. Okay, so the piece I'm about to play is by a fellow named Crespo. Enrique Crespo? Is that his name, Mark? Enrique Crespo, trombone player from Uruguay, known mostly for his work with the German brass. This is a piece called Improvisation Number 1. I don't think he ever wrote number 2, so let's just call it Improvisation. And it's a piece I enjoy playing. The first time I heard it, it made me think of, and all the trombone players, we can relate to this. You know, you're in your basement and you're just kind of doodling away and just sort of playing licks and playing riffs, and you know, so I think what he did is he recorded himself doing just that, and then he kind of strung it all together. So when I hear it, I can just sort of think of myself in my basement kind of walking around, and so when I perform it, I like to kind of put myself in that headspace. Just a few things about the piece. You'll hear a few themes. The one that comes up the most is just a sort of a run of fourths, you know. That kind of thing. You're going to hear that a lot. And also a more of a linear chromatic thing that he uses a lot. Kind of thing, different speeds and different dynamics. So, and there's a little funky part in the middle, so anyway, I can't put it off any longer. Here we go. This is Improvisation by Crespo. Here we go. And you'll know it's over because it ends the same way that it starts. Okay? Just a heads up.
40 years ago, seems like a lifetime ago, 40 years ago, I was a student at the Eastman School of Music, and I was putting together a recital of bass trombone music, and there was a piece that I was working on. It had been composed recently by an American icon. Uniquely American composer. His name was Alec Wilder. He was self-trained. Some might even consider him to be a bit of a quirky fellow. He never actually owned a home. He lived all around, just living with friends and in hotels and sending letters to all kinds of folks. And he just wrote music for his friends. And he wrote this piece. He was a famous songwriter. He wrote some music for Frank Sinatra. And because of that, he met this bass trombone player by the name of George Roberts, who was kind of a big hero for all of us. And he wrote this sonata for George. But George was kind of a studio player. He didn't really do this kind of thing. So he never played it. And my teacher at Eastman at the time recorded it, but It was a little on the straighter side. So as I'm getting ready to do my recital, a lot of times we'd walk out in the main hallway at Eastman, and there would be Wilder sitting there in the main hall. And so I went up to him and I said, "Sir, I'm going to be playing your piece on my recital," and thinking, I was just thanking him for writing it. Sure enough, he showed up, came to my recital, wrote me one of his famous little notes afterwards. 40 years ago, almost to the day. So here we are, Alec Wilder's Sonata for Bass Trombone. When Kathy gets here, there we are. Thank you.
Thank you.
playing the piano. Okay, well, we're waiting for a few stray dogs here coming in. Hope you've enjoyed it so far. Aren't they fantastic musicians? Oh my gosh. To close out the first half, we certainly hope you can hang around for the second half. There's some really fantastic things going on the second half. We're going to end the first half with a piece by Leonard Bernstein, wonderful composer, conductor, American icon. We just spent the past year celebrating him and his music. He wrote this piece called Mass when they opened up the Kennedy Center. And it was for a huge conglomeration of folks. We did the Mass here a few years ago. Orchestra, rock band, kind of all kinds of different paraphernalia goes into performing the Mass. But in the middle of this thing, it stops. And there's a celebrant who sings to the crowd with him and his guitar and sings a simple song. And that's what Mr. Nitzan Hiros is going to do for you, Bernstein's simple song.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, in my opinion, the trombone is the true head of the family of wind instruments, which I have named the epic one. It possesses nobility and grandeur to the highest degree. It has all the serious and powerful tones of sublime musical poetry, from religious calm and imposing accents to savage, orgiastic outbursts. Directed by the will of the master, the trombones can chant like a choir of priests, threaten utter gloomy sighs, a mournful lament, or a bright hymn of glory. They can break forth into awe-inspiring cries and awaken the dead or doom the living with their fearful voices. Hector Berlioz was a smart guy. And so when he wrote this piece, one of the first pieces for large wind band, he had the second movement feature the trombone. In this funeral sermon, this recitative and prayer. And so the master of this particular occasion is Mr. Peter Sullivan.
Thank you. So, no, yes, wow, nice picture. I just want to say it is so wonderful to be here tonight. You are so incredibly lucky to have this new hall built, and I'm truly touched and honored that Mark included me in this very special program. It's just really fantastic. I'm so impressed by the architecture, and even more importantly, acoustically, how it sounds here. And I really hope and wish that every one of you who is capable of playing will find the opportunity to stand here and do what we're doing, because this is what it's all about. And it's truly fantastic. Sharing the stage with Mark and Pete is both a great honor, true fun, and also, as you can imagine, a frightening experience. Don't try it at home. But again, thank you, Mark, and thank you, Pete. It's for me so incredible to have the opportunity to play with both of you. Unfortunately, I did not have the fortune of meeting Mr. Irby Green, but he indeed inspired me very much, as he did so many other trombone players. And I'm just saddened that I missed the opportunity. And again, I feel very lucky that through, Mark, the spirit, the tradition continues, and people like myself and you can enjoy and continue to enjoy the fabulous work of this incredible human being and trombone player. Now we'll finish by saying that life is incredible, and there are some very special people out there, and I encourage all of you to take the time and to seek the opportunity to visit people like Irby Green, even when they get older and maybe they're not what they used to be. The human being is still there, and the legend is still there. Don't miss out like I did. If you have a hero, if you know someone who inspires you, go visit them. You know, it's possible. And thank you, Irby, for everything you did for us. And that's it. I'm going to continue now with the Stefan Schulik Sonata in One Movement for trombone and piano, or piano and trombone, however you want to look at it. And thank you, Kathy, for joining us. Yes.
Thank you.
Really? I thought it was you. Me? I don't know anything about it. I know that I love Schubert. And see, your name's first, so you have to introduce it. No. You're German is better than mine, right? Auf dem Strom means, obviously.
Nice.
Somebody help me out here. I think it means by the brook or by the stream. Is that it?
Mm-hmm.
It's a leader. I mean, it's a lead. It's a song, beautiful song. It's really all you need to know. Schubert. It's for French horn originally.
Cello and piano.
Voice, cello, and piano. So we've kind of rearranged it here for the three of us. So that's pretty well all I have. So I hope you enjoy it.
If you can bear with us just a little bit, we've just got two more tunes for you. The first one, I'd like just to take a moment, if I could. Again, 40 years ago, this piece was written for a young man at Eastman who, while didn't study with Emory Remington, was very much influenced by him and his teaching. They called Emory Remington the chief. And so they created this scholarship in his honor, and I won this, was awarded this scholarship, and Dr. Marcellus, the teacher, had this piece written for me to perform. At Eastman, they needed some phys ed requirements. So they used to have a gym. And but after a while, all those musicians kind of got a little, didn't want to deal with the phys ed requirements. So they turned the gym into a big rehearsal room, and they called it the Remington Room. And this piece was written for that dedication. So it seemed appropriate again to do it again tonight. It's always a pleasure to play with the students, my friends, and these folks are a special bunch of folks, and I'm really proud to teach them. And one of the things I try to teach them is that your music isn't going to mean something to somebody if it doesn't mean anything to you. And so one of the ways to help make it mean a little bit more sometimes is playing it for someone. And tonight, we're privileged to have our chief, the Penn State chief, the guy who inspires us every day. He came to hear us play, and we're very much appreciative of that. So we'd like to dedicate this performance of the chief to Mr. Dennis Glocky. Thank you. Give us just a second. We have a beautiful, beautiful piece to play for you to end the evening. I'll tell you a little bit about it. But first, I have to make some thanks. First, thanks to all the people who played, Marco Marcinko, Mac Himes, the incredible Kathy Sinatel, all the trombone students, but of course, our guests, Pete and Nitzan, for an incredible evening of music making. It wouldn't have happened. We all play different instruments. I play for an instrument for the Shires Company. Pete plays one for the Yamaha Instrument Company. And Nitzan plays one from the Edwards Instrument Company. They helped us out a little bit tonight, and we're thankful for that. We're also thankful to the School of Music for helping support this event tonight as well. But of course, to you for coming out and checking it out. We thank you very much. 63 of these. I don't know if I'm going to do 63 more, but we'll see how far we go. So we'd like to close out tonight's performance with a piece that I heard just in my random listening. Man, it was beautiful. And I looked back, and it had been arranged for the choir some years ago in its original form. The composer is Kurt Bester, and you might not know Kurt particularly by name, but you hear his music all the time in different Disney productions and other TV situations, and he's just a really busy, successful composer, songwriter. But some of his travels took him to Eastern Europe at one point in his life, and it was kind of a war-torn place, and he really got to thinking about the biggest victims of these kinds of things, which are the children. And so he put together this song called The Prayer of the Children. Since that time, it's been used for numerous, numerous occasions where, regretfully, children are caught in the crossfire. But I heard this version of it, and I thought, man, wouldn't that be cool to do that with Pete and Nitzan and the choir? And so I called up one of our illustrious alumni, a great writer for trombone music. His name is Scott Slutter. And I said, Scott, can you help me with this? And he did it. Scott is wonderful. And so thank you, Scott, out there for making this happen. Thank you for being here. We have one more huge, huge thank you to these two incredible artists for joining us here at Penn State. The prayer of the children.
Thank you.
that was, I think I needed that. Oh, did I?
Yeah.
I think I remember, but what was the concert?
We were playing poker at your house.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. See, it all comes full circle. That's good to know. So I was thinking that too. I went, we were in Philadelphia for the President's concert, and a friend of mine, I was too nervous to go and get a drink. Mm-hmm. She got one for me, and she was underage too.
Oh.
But. Anyway, so it was a long time ago, but hopefully you guys need more legal. Anyway, good to see you again. Hopefully
nice meeting you.